Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the first session of IIoT India Digital Connect series. Digital Connect, or DigiCon series as we like to call it, is a series of virtual sessions directed at addressing the needs and challenges of manufacturing industry in today's time and sharing the experiences and learnings within the industry. The topic for today is leveraging digital tech in Indian manufacturing to thrive in the new normal. Well, our lives have been upheaved by the pandemic, and there is a need to rethink our process and systems. Manufacturing industry has taken a major hit due to supply chain disruption and labor shortage. There is a lot of uncertainty prevailing in the market right now, but there is no doubt about the fact that the industry will have to transform, although this transformation will be manifold and different for different organizations. Our panelists here will be sharing their experiences and learnings, which will help you in charting your own future course. Before I proceed to introduce our panelists for today's discussion, let's take a quick poll. All right, let's take a look at what you think about the digital transformation process. So kindly choose the appropriate option. Okay. You can choose the most appropriate option, or you can also choose all of the above. All right. So 45% of our audience thinks that clear digital roadmap with well-defined priorities is the first step towards digital transformation journey. Well, that's a very good insight of what our audience thinks. Now, without taking up too much of your time, I would like to go ahead and introduce our panelists for today. I want to start off with our moderator for today, without whose guidance this session would not have been possible, Mr. Sunil David, who is the original director IoT at AT&T. Mr. David has 26 years of experience in the IT and telecom industry and is working on building a robust partner ecosystem for AT&T in the entire value chain. He was awarded as India's fastest growing leaders 2019-2020 Pride of the Nation at 13th edition of Asian Business. He has spoken at more than 50 industry forums in India and abroad, organized by leading industry bodies. It gives me immense pleasure in sharing that he's also on our event, IIoT India's International Advisory Committee. Thank you for joining us today, Mr. David.
Thank you, Omika.
Next, we have Dr. Shankar Venugopal, Vice President Innovation with Mahindra & Mahindra. Dr. Shankar leads technology innovation for automotive and farm services business and heads the intellectual property and knowledge management functions. He's also the Dean of Mahindra Technical Academy and is passionate about developing sustainable urban mobility solutions, and his current interests span across electric vehicles, connected vehicles, autonomous vehicles, and precision farming. Welcome, sir. Our next panelist is Mr. Rajkiran, Senior Director and Head IoT AR Business at PTC. He is helping organizations chalk out their digital transformation plans with IoT AR technology. He is responsible for ThinkWorks and Zuforia business of PTC in India, IoT and AR solutions built for industrial market for product modification and factory operation optimization. Welcome, sir. Next, we have on the panel Mr. Lokesh Pai, Chief of Digital Enterprise at Bosch India. Evangelizing the digital revolution at Bosch, Mr. Pai is focusing on connected industry, or Industry 4.0, for emerging markets. He has over a decade of proven track record in managing and scaling up business, playing with new age technologies like IoT and services, AR and user experience, to name a few. Welcome. Finally, we have Mr. Saurabh Ganeriwala, Group Chief Digital Officer at Jindal Steel & Power. Mr. Ganeriwala boasts of 21 years of experience spanning across manufacturing, industrial, telecom infra services, financial services, software consulting, and global research. He has proven ability to leverage technology and grow leadership talent to transform business processes. which support companies' competitiveness in the market. He's currently responsible for digitization at Jindal Steel and Power across both enterprise IT and industrial IT. It is an honor to have stalwarts like all of you on the panel today. Welcome all of you once again. I now request our audience to take a very quick poll so that our panelists know you better and can streamline the discussion accordingly today. Don't worry, it will not take you more than 15 seconds to answer them. So just scroll on and choose the right answer according to you. I would also like to inform you that we've received an enormous number of queries from all of you present in the audience today. Our panelists will address them during and after the session. You're welcome to interact and ask more questions via the Q&A function on your screens below. You can also choose to upvote a question that has already been asked by someone else that will help us to prioritize. Any questions which remain unanswered can be posted to our IIoT India DigiCon series interchange platform, the link to which will be provided towards the end of the session. I can see a lot of people have already voted. We're waiting for the rest of them to vote as well, and then we can proceed with our discussion today. The answers to these questions will help our panelists to know you better, and they can streamline today's discussion accordingly. Okay. I can see a few of you are still left to answer the questions. All right. So to proceed, I will now request Mr. David to take the discussion forward. Over to you, Mr. David.
Yeah, thank you so much, Nitya. And good afternoon to all the delegates who have joined us virtually. And a warm welcome to all my panelists. At the outset, I would like to thank Syngex for giving me the opportunity to moderate this panel session on the topic of how digital technology can be leveraged to ensure that the manufacturing industry in India can thrive in the new normal. Can you please play my slides, please? Next slide. Right, now, just to set the context, the manufacturing industry is so critical to India's GDP growth, right? Today, it contributes almost 17% to our GDP and employs close to 12% of our workforce. And within the manufacturing industry, there are about 63 million MSMEs in India, contributing to employment and exports, plus a lot of the almost 40% of total manufacturing output today is from the MSME industry. And there have been various policies from the government in the past, starting with the National Manufacturing Policy in 2011 to the Make in India initiative in 2014, and the more recently launched Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan, which is all about self-reliance. And all these policies, the whole objective of this is to make sure that we are able to get manufacturing contribution to GDP to 25%. And in the process, create close to 100 million jobs. And friends, the only way this can be achieved is by leveraging the power of digital technology. Next slide, please. Now, if you just look at the manufacturing use cases, I kind of club it into three different buckets, right? So on one side, what happens within a factory, within a shop floor, which I call as inside the enterprise. And then the second and third is what happens outside, right? Now, within the manufacturing shop floor, within a factory, you are used to the traditional use cases, which you are all aware of, right? So predictive maintenance of machines, energy management, optimization of process, inventory optimization. These have been the traditional use cases of manufacturing within a shop floor. The second thing is the connected products. And I think this is where perhaps Indian manufacturers perhaps would need to perhaps move up, because a lot of the products that are built today, whether it is industrial products like compressors or pumps or motors, generators, they are not traditionally connected products. Even consumer appliances, of late we are seeing companies wanting to add compute and intelligence into these products. But I think there's a long way to go in terms of how we can make these products more connected, because the moment you make these products connected, that's when you're able to glean a lot of insights from how consumers are using these products. And then you can add a lot more features depending on what the consumer wants, right? So connected products, definitely an area for the manufacturing industry to work on. And I think we're going to see an evolution to where manufacturers who today are offering a product might probably offer product as a service. And that means that they need to innovate around their business models to offer something like that. Thirdly, the supply chain part. And I think all of us have seen how the supply chain has got badly disrupted because of COVID-19, right? So today the need is for making the supply chains not just visible, but even more resilient, right? So use cases around track and trace, fleet management, all that becomes very, very relevant going forward. Next slide, please. Now, having talked about all these use cases across these three different buckets, what have been the challenges as far as adopting IIoT in India is concerned? And I'm going to pick on a few here, which came up from a study which a leading management consulting firm called Russell Reynolds Associates, they actually came up with this study last year when they interviewed a number of senior leaders from across India. And they very interestingly came up with, you know, three things. One is that while there are major factors which contribute to manufacturing company not adopting IIoT, but what is interesting is the first, you know, the point which is given here is 66% say it's knowledge gap, right? Which means there's a lot more awareness that is now needed within the manufacturing industry in terms of what are the various solutions that are possible, what are the different kinds of use cases. So I think there's a need for industry bodies, for experts to kind of interact very closely with the industry to make sure that we bridge this knowledge gap. Secondly, the lack of the right culture to absorb I4.0 changes. I think that's so, so important. I think it has to obviously be a top-down approach. You need the buy-in from the top before you can get that to percolate down to the entire organization. Third is the risk appetite. I think that's another factor. You know, there are always these questions that company heads pose, you know, what if I implement it? What's the risk? And of course, there are other factors like, you know, the talent. I think that's a very, very important issue. The skills, you know, you need people with the relevant skills within organizations to implement digital technologies. And this is an area I think we really need to focus on. And of course, funding is a challenge. Questions around ROI is always being propped up. How do you make sure that when I invest in this, am I getting the ROI? Right? These are the typical challenges that we encounter from the manufacturing industry. Next slide, please. Now, just look at what happened before the pandemic had struck, right? In terms of what was the focus of manufacturers, it was the typical thing, right? Your cost reduction initiatives, wanting to improve productivity, sustainability, and we have seen automation in very few pockets. And the whole objective of automation was to give a competitive advantage and maybe to reduce cost. Now, what has happened after the pandemic has hit us, right? What's happened is automation is now needed for survival and for sustenance. There's no question about it, right? You need to automate, you need to digitize. And there's also a trend where we are seeing where you need to have that real-time visibility of all your assets, whether it is machinery in the shop floor or products deployed in the field. The need for real-time visibility, remote operation, these are the kind of use cases that we'll perhaps see a lot more adoption of going forward. We've also seen an interesting trend where manufacturers are also repurposed their production lines to make different kinds of products. I know Mahindra and even Ashok Leyland were also making ventilators, right? So they were using these production lines for those kind of manufacturing. They're also wanting to sell excess capacity. And the whole objective now is, while we sustain, how do we plan for regrowth? Right? I think that's going to be the key focus for manufacturers. And obviously, adoption of Industry 4 becomes very, very critical. Please move to the next slide. Now, the factors that would aid digital manufacturing in India. Now, given the challenges that the manufacturing industry is facing, I think there are enough drivers now for manufacturing industry to seriously consider accelerating their digital initiatives, given that the whole survival is in question. And a few things which I wanted to bring to your attention. The first thing is that the cost of cloud storage has come down significantly, right? So now we are able to move applications to the cloud. The cost of compute and storage and the cloud and storage has come down. And my understanding is that most of the guys who provide cloud services, be it an Amazon or a Google or an IBM, they are very flexible in terms of how they price cloud services. So if I'm not mistaken, Amazon reduces prices of their cloud computing almost like 15, 16 times a year, right? Secondly, the cost of connectivity has also come down. So the need to move data from an environment in a manufacturing place to the cloud, the cost of connectivity has come down significantly, right? And secondly, there are far more options for connectivity today. Cellular is one, satellite communication, wired, low power WAN networks. So I think there are enough and more options now for connectivity, apart from the fact that the cost of connectivity has come down significantly. Thirdly, reduced energy consumption. So today we have smart meters where you can track your consumption of all your equipment in your factory in real time, right? So traditionally meters could only track the overall consumption, but now you can do it at an equipment level, right? So I think this is one great use case where you can reduce the cost of energy because that is a very significant portion of your overall cost. And finally, friends, the cost of sensors has also come down. The cost of IoT devices has come down significantly. I think there's still a long way to go as far as India is concerned when it comes to making devices, because a lot of our components, the chipsets, the memory modules, the PCBs, they're all coming from other countries. And hopefully the Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan initiative will give that fillip that is needed to make all these stuff in India. We don't have enough fabs in India. I think that's another area which perhaps needs a think on. So the cost of devices definitely is coming down, and we'll probably see this coming down even further, because today when we have use cases for any requirement, I think the cost of devices constitute almost like 30-40% of the overall cost. And if we're actually able to bring that down, that will definitely give a fillip to adoption of Industry 4.0. Now, given these factors that are going to aid digital manufacturing in India, next slide, please. The question is, given these positive drivers and the fact that adopting digital is non-negotiable, how does Indian manufacturers not just survive, but thrive in the new normal? And that's the question that I'm going to pose to all the eminent panelists who are part of the session. So with that, before I move to the first question, it's a very straightforward format. None of my panelists are going to present any slides. We want to make it a very free-flowing discussion. We wanted to be in a very conversational mode. And we had received a few offline questions, which you'll also get the panelists to address that. And we want to finish this by one, and then we leave the last 15 minutes for question and answer. So my suggestion to all those who want to pose questions is that please use the Q&A window there to pose your question. If you are directing it to any panelist, please mention the name of the panelist while you're directing that question. So without further ado, I'm moving straight to Shankar. Shankar, thank you so much for joining this panel. Always a pleasure to interact with you. We've known each other for quite almost 2-3 years now. Now, Shankar, my question to you is, look at adoption of Industry 4.0 and automotive industry. And traditionally, if you just look at manufacturing, auto industry maybe hasn't really caught up compared to the other industries when it comes to adoption of Industry 4.0. So if you can broadly share, what are we seeing today in the automotive industry? What are the trends that you can share? And maybe you can share a few use cases in terms of how Mahindra, the company, is accelerating some of your digital initiatives, and share those use cases, Shankar. Shankar?
Sure, Sunil. Can you hear me clear?
You're on mute, Shankar. I think you.
No, I have unmuted.
We can hear you.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Can you hear now?
Yeah, we can hear you now. Yeah.
Excellent. Sure. So, automotive industry is a very, very happening place in terms of a variety of disruptions, both in terms of technology disruptions and also business model disruptions. So, for us, digitization of manufacturing is something very, very important at this particular stage. We see the transition to electric, connected, and autonomous vehicles happening in a real big way. And apart from these technology disruptions, we also have this shared mobility coming in as a very, very big business model disruption. So when we go through this, we are primarily looking at how do we make sure that we build the capability for these transitions and make India the hub, a global hub for electric vehicles. So this is a real, real big opportunity space for us. And the manufacturing of electric vehicles is very, very different as compared to manufacturing of the current generation automotive vehicles. So we are looking at primarily building capacity in India to make electric vehicles and take them to different other parts of the globe. And we started our journey a little early on in terms of our venture into the electric vehicle space. And early 2000, we made our very first electric vehicle called the Bijli. And it was tough at the time to keep the cost low because we had to import a lot of those components. But over time, we have built in-house capability to build a strong portfolio of electric vehicles here in India. And the electric vehicle business operates out of Bangalore, and that's a Mahindra Electric business. So we have primarily been looking at how we can digitize our manufacturing plants and bring in abilities for us to remotely monitor the operations and plan, and also not just monitor, but also integrate and have local analytics in place to have a very systematic planning of the production activity and have a good control over the overall productivity and efficiencies. This is where we started our journey a few years back. Now we have a fairly good level of automation of our manufacturing plants, not only for the electric vehicles that we have in Bangalore and in Pune, Chakan and Pune, but we also have state-of-the-art plants in Zairabad and also in Haridwar. All these plants have very active, very passionate Industry 4.0 champions who are driving this initiative in a very big way over the years. And in fact, it was this preparedness that helped us to actually start using our engines plant at Igatpuri to start making those ventilators a couple of months back. And this was, in fact, one of the relatively older plants. But when it comes to a level of automation and the agility with which they can switch over from engines to ventilators, it was really, really made possible because of the levels of automation and digitization that we have in these plants. So I think this is a very, very important phase for us to build in-house capability in India to make electric vehicles. And with when I talk about electric, connected and autonomous features comes along with that. And all this will be made possible only by going for across the plant digitization at all levels, not just operations, but end-to-end digitization of our manufacturing. So this is very important for us going forward. And I'd be more than happy to share a couple of examples in terms of our own early experiences in making this work for us.
Sure, Shankar, maybe you can share one of the examples. Maybe I'll come back to you later on that. Yeah, maybe you can share one example to start with.
Yeah, sure. So we primarily looked at one of the key areas we looked at was in terms of addressing the skill gap. And when you look at the traditional workforce, in the automotive industries, it's typically the mechanical engineers. Most of them would be mechanical. And when we look at the products and also the manufacturing, the digital manufacturing, we need to bring in a lot of electrical, electronics, and also computer science knowledge to our task force. So we started this journey about 4 years back. We launched the Tech Ladder, through which we are able to reskill about engineers, both in the product development organization and also across manufacturing plants, to quickly pick up these digital skills. So it was a three-year journey where the first year was spent in absorbing all this new technology knowledge. And over the next 2 years, each one of them had individual projects to work on where they could actually adapt these digital technologies to their corresponding domains, their own workspaces, and successfully master the practical application of these technologies. Over a three-year period, the entire engineering force, both in the product development and also in the manufacturing plants, are now digitally savvy. So this is the very first initiative that we launched because we wanted to make sure that everybody has a basic level of skills. And now we are focusing on the next stage, which is digital data analytics, data science foundational programs across for all these engineers so that they get into the next phase of looking at the rich data that we have and pulling out very meaningful insights out of this rich data. So this is where we were, which is phase two of our initiative right now.
Right. Thanks, Shankar, for sharing. So I'll come back to you on the skills part and also on the leveraging of the data analytics sure. The next round. Saurabh, now Jindal Steel has presence not just in India, but outside as well. You all make for the domestic market, export also to other countries. And Saurabh, can you broadly share from a manufacturing industry standpoint, what are those kind of use cases that you think will see a lot more adoption going forward, given the pandemic situation that we are faced with? That's one. Secondly, Saurabh, if you can also share very briefly some of the challenges that you may have encountered while adopting IIoT, or maybe some of your peers might be sharing with you. If you can also briefly share, that would be great, Saurabh.
Great. So good afternoon, everybody. I hope I am heard loud and clear.
Yes, we can.
Thank you. So let us start, you have asked a very interesting question. So let us start with a fundamental question of why Internet of Things for manufacturing at all, right? What all it can solve? Actually, it can resolve system complexities, increase information visibility, and improve production performance, right? So these are the three areas around which you typically look for any Internet of Things aspect to start with, right? Basically, it is nothing but a cyber physical system integrating back to your manufacturing systems in the physical world with the virtual cyberspace, right? So that's how I look at it. And I would not hesitate to call it as IOMT, which is Internet of Manufacturing Things, to make it even more precise and more focused towards manufacturing, right? IOMT is nothing but a data enabled engineering operations, right? That's how I would put it in a very simple words, right? So let's first start with further splitting that what all IoT can do, right? IoT may deploy sensors to monitor machine conditions. IoT can generate data, can access data, which not only includes historical data, signals and measurements collected from large number of machines, but also online monitoring data of machines, right? Once you have this sensing data, you have machine signatures. You can develop tools and methods to do diagnostic, prognostics, and optimizations, right? Once you have all of this, then the physical world starts reflecting the cyberspace because you have the data to drive the information processing, modeling, and simulation, which is when the analytics part comes in, right? And this basically leads you to decide that how is the project giving value, right? So given this context of what are the things which are happening in IOMT, and where all it can be used. Now let us look at one of the important terms here. There is a term called T, which is things, right? Internet of Manufacturing Things. So let us first understand also, what is manufacturing thing? It is material, it is sensors, it is equipments, it is people, it is products, and it is also supply chain, right? So things is so large, it is such a large landscape. So let's not restrict. So one of the confusions which everybody has is that whenever we talk of IoT, it's only machine, right? It's actually so many things together, right? Yeah. When you have a large number of network machines which are used increasingly to carry out manufacturing operations, they are typically in a sequence, right? Or a pipeline production kind of setup, right? These network machines can be configured dynamically to increase flexibility and adaption to any customized task. Right now, what are the typical use cases given all of these contexts which we have seen in our industry? So first and foremost, to start with, condition monitoring and quality control, right? That's the first one, and it's the easiest one to crack because you have so many sensors, you have so many devices which are there even on the legacy equipments, right? But most of them do not feed back data or loop back data into our L2 systems, right? They are just point in time. So we can do a lot of things on the condition monitoring and effective quality control. Once we have the data, you can get onto planning and scheduling, right? You can proactively assign a machine's workload onto other machine and schedule maintenance when a machine is moving towards machine failure cluster in the entire network, right? So you have a sequence of machines and one of the machines is giving you an indication that it's ready for maintenance, you can actually plan your entire maintenance. So this is a very important second use case. Last but not the least, when it gets into smart manufacturing, right? This is where, as Dr. Shankar Venugopal was mentioning, right? When you start doing analytics on this data, right? That's when you start talking to the machines. That's when you start taking decisions basis the data, right? This will actually help you to create substantial value from the data, optimize your operations and reduce maintenance cost and equipment downtime, right? In nutshell, in my opinion, IoMT provides an unprecedented opportunity to link the things which I just mentioned at the start, services and application, right? All of this together, if you put together the digital integration of entire manufacturing is a big, big use case for manufacturing. That's how I would put what are the use cases and how it kind of puts a context. Now, talking about the challenges, right? First thing, any IoMT system, the efficacy of that is dependent on interconnections, right? Interconnections between all the different types of things which I talked about, right? I talked about six things at the beginning, right? You can have different communication protocol, you can have different processing mechanisms, you can have different storage types, you can have different power supplies, you can have different data types. So these are few of the things which kinds of puts different challenges across, right? First is you have everything which you put in IoMT has a unique IP, right? Each unique IP needs, so if you remember, I think it was in 2012 or 13 when IPv4 got translated to IPv6, right? And we all were thinking, why is it so? And it was just to prepare us for this, right? So that's the biggest challenge. Are your devices ready to support IPv6? What is your setup? How prepared are you on that, right? So that's one. Next, if you look at it, the data management. Now, each of these devices or sensors are communicating large volume of that data at a very high velocity, right? It means you need specialized data management techniques, data access, data structure, data compression, data synthesis, data traceability, data retrieval. It's a completely different data science altogether, right? It's not a traditional way of handling the data, right? That's the challenge number two. Third, you have information which is getting processed at a flick of a time, right? So there's a need to process the data to extract meaningful information from individual machines and make a correlation across the entire chain, right? Now, when you are doing this, you have to think about data in frequency domain, wavelet domain, state space domain. There are so many statistical parameters which comes into play, right? How do you put all of this together, connect all the functions and tasks, and then find out that what is the interconnection giving you, right? That's the second one. Third, or the fourth one, in fact, it's about decision-making, right? You do analytics, you do lot of analytics, it gives you a lot of feedback, right? How much of smartness you want to actually use to take some decisions, right? Fifth, stability and security on the communication protocols. You have so many of them. It starts from FTP, HTTP, TCP/IP. You can do communication over LoRa. You can do communication over Wi-Fi. You can do communication over any of these channels, right? Which one of them is stable? Which one of them is secure? Right? You have actually safeguarded everything on your network, but if your communication channel is weak, you can actually get broken, right? Last but not the least, every manufacturing unit has legacy machines, which are invaluable assets. For IoT, they can be changed. You have to actually look at those machines, understand what are the abilities or capabilities those machines have to build your IoMT infrastructure, right? While you are doing all of this, one of the other challenges which happens is when you are architecting this, how do you define your factory hierarchy? How do you define your architecture, your product lifecycle, and the entire setup, the ecosystem of IoT landscape, right? IoT is not just IoT. It is cloud computing, analytics, AR, VR, computer vision, all of this put together, which are enabling technologies to make your IoMT successful, right? I hope I have answered both of your questions, Sunil.
Yeah, it does. Saurabh, I think you made a very interesting acronym. You coined an interesting acronym, IOMT. And I think very valid point about the fact that you have all this legacy machines on how does that coexist with the newer machines that you have, right? I think that's so important. And also the relevance of data analytics. I think Saurabh, other important point is that given the data, the humongous amount of data and the fact that you need to extract value from the data, the need for skills becomes very important, right? You need to have those relevant skills within your organization who can be able to crunch all the data and give you those insights, right? I think, is that also a possible challenge, Saurabh?
Cannot agree more. Mm-hmm. I mean, I can only say that and re-emphasize on it that skills become one of the most important thing. Otherwise, as I said, you have data, but you don't know how to process it.
Right, absolutely. Thanks, Saurabh. I'll come back to you with my next question after I finish with Lokesh and Raj. So Lokesh, over to you. So Bosch is in a very unique position, right? So as a company, you'll consume a lot of IoT because you have your plants across the world. And plus, you're also offering solutions to your customers, predominantly auto, but I understand that you're also trying to deal and also address other industry segments. So if you can broadly share, what are the trends that you're seeing? You know, what are your customers seeing? And maybe share also within Bosch, how have you seen acceleration happen from a digital transformation standpoint, Lokesh?
Thanks, Sunil. Thanks for the opportunity. Good afternoon, everyone. I can't agree more with Shankar and Saurabh's explanation about how the industrial IoT is disrupting the auto OEM. And Saurabh very well detailed out all the technology and use cases. So at Bosch, we started this journey way back in 2012, Sunil. When we joined hands with three of other companies who were also competitors and university to come up with a so-called Bible or Bhagavad Gita for industrial IoT. So we came up with a white paper in 2012. So that detailed out what is industrial IoT, what is this industry 4.0, and how would it help a manufacturing enterprise. And from then we took it rather serious. So there was a lead provider and lead user. Two other strategies which were detailed out in that white paper. So at Bosch, we started as lead user. We are a 270 plus worldwide plants. We're an 80 billion organization worldwide presence. So each of the plant has a mother plant which is connected, and there is a value stream which is running across for the product families. While automotive is predominantly a dominant component manufacturer, but we do have home appliances. Few of you guys are using us, I'm sure. And industrial equipment and the power tools and a few others. So what we did way back then, 2013-14, predominantly was to create a momentum inside organization that there's an animal called industry 4.0. There's an animal called industrial IoT. Don't be scared of it. Let's start as a blue collar person, which I'm proud of in a manufacturing unit. You know in and out about your processes, you know in and out about that particular machine. And you know what's going to go wrong. Even in the mid of the night, if you wake up and you say, this particular machine has a problem, you know how I'm going to correct it. So hence, the industrial IoT was a change initiative to start with. So we created a lot of pilots. We did allocate a budget. We gave free hand to people to start doing whatever they wish to do. Legacy machines, as Saurabh and Shankar highlighted, was a major point of conflict for us because all of us, you will not be able to. If it is a new greenfield, it's very easy because you're going to design the layout and you're going to design the machine and you're going to design the connectivity layer. What if a legacy machine? Recently, 2 years ago in Hanover MSA, we connected our 132-year-old lathe machine, which was used by Mr. Robert Bosch. We connected with sensors, we connected with the production performance system, a PPE, which is ours, and connected the data to IoT cloud of Bosch and started getting insights into it. So that's the possibility. So first 2 years went along doing something and feeling about it and also fail fast switching. We created a lot of momentum. We started, in fact, giving the award for best copy. Someone in the copy is known as a negative terminology, but in manufacturing, we encourage people to copy from A plant to B plant. So that would give us number one learning. That would give us number two, a reduced development or implementation time. So 2015 onwards, we took it very seriously. We did a value stream analysis, arrived at a use cases as Saurabh mentioned, and attacked those use cases with a relevant technology solution of Industry 4.0. We started creating based on 3-4 years of hands-on experience, we came up with a NextSeed platform, NextSeed framework, whatever you want to call it, a bundle of solutions, which is going to address the entire value stream of plan, source, make, and deliver. That's the value stream of supply chain, right? And that we started implementing. So currently, out of all our plans are connected. Fewer plans have moved to a maturity level of, say, highest level, where there is a seamless data being connected. All machines are connected, close to 6,500 machines. Supply chain is completely digitized, zero paper, and also you can get the data sitting wherever on the earth. I hope the skies will open so that we can fly around again to access our iPads and see what machine has what data, and leading to all the use cases which Saurabh mentioned: condition monitoring, predictive maintenance, planning, traceability, supply chain traceability, to manufacturing traceability, quality parameters, everything what you need to make the right decision. After that, in 2016, when I took over in 2015 as a startup internally at Bosch, I was a one man, built up a team together. We started taking this to our non-Bosch customers. While we had a easy conversations with automotive like Mahindra, Tata's, whoever it is, we also started getting attraction with non-automotive components, which is textiles, steel, and a few others. Because fundamentally, the basic of manufacturing remains almost like a pattern, right? It's a value stream analysis, you write use cases, connect the machines, connect the value stream and get the data. Well, what you need is a domain knowledge. So we went along telling that we are an implementation to partners. We do consult your blueprinting, we implement. We started having a lot of tie-ups with our competitors, including Siemens, SAP, PDC, whoever is it. And we decided that you cannot be a single player here, it's an ecosystem player. Hence, we started taking that as we go further. Multiple use cases, multiple experience, a lot of finger burnt. We did feel what it makes to happen, make it happen in industrial IoT. Happy to share as we go further, Sunil.
Great. Thanks, Lokesh. If I'm not mistaken, Lokesh, there's also a Center for Excellence for IoT in Bangalore, right? I think which was opened last year. Right, Lokesh?
Yes, Bangalore? We do train people. We decided that we can, based on all this learning, we customize it in a training module and a hands-on experiencing model. So we created a Center of Excellence. We created a digital workshop kind of a center in Bangalore where we do host a lot of customers, a lot of our suppliers, and a lot of MSMEs to take their digitization further.
Great. Just one quick follow-up question for you, Lokesh. And since you mentioned that you're trying to de-risk and try to target non-auto industry, and ever since the pandemic has struck, what are your clients telling you? What are the predominant use cases are they wanting to deploy, you know, given this current situation? Because I know that they are constrained from a CapEx standpoint, they may not want to invest. So broadly, if you can just share one or two trends or use cases that your clients have been telling you over the last few months, Lokesh, briefly.
Sure. Sunil, a lot of our customers are going back to the drawing phase. Yeah, they're going to the understanding, and they're all earlier. What used to happen whenever I used to attend customers, they say that, hey, Lokesh, can we start implementing solution? They were in a hurry. I remember one of my customers thought that I'm getting a magic wand like a USB.
Lokesh, I think. Sorry, go ahead, Lokesh. We lost you for a second. Yeah.
So earlier my customer used to say that start implementing, but now that all of customers are telling, let's go back to the drawing board. Let's create a proper blueprint. Understand where do we have to invest rather than jump onto it. All of us looking at pilot is done, dusted. No one wants to do pilot. No one wants to do proof of concept. Everyone wants to do proof of scale. They're telling that let's take one value stream and do a proof of scale. One of a question in earlier survey, what I noticed is where do we start? So the best way to start is create a blueprint. Use this pandemic where all of us are sitting at home, restricted movement, restricted manufacturing happening. Use your brain thinking, wear the hat of thinking and start creating a right blueprint. As soon as the pandemic gets over, as soon as the vaccines are out, we're going to go back and trust me, we won't have a single minute to breathe. We're going to get back to the work doing.
Right. Thanks, Lokesh. You talked about proof of scale. I think the mantra for any digital transformation initiative, think big, start small, and scale fast. I think if you scale fast, I think that's when you really, that's when the rubber really hits the road, right? Raj, you know, you represent PTC, well-known in the industry, very strong in the manufacturing space. I have a two-part question for you, Raj. So firstly, you know, can you briefly share what are your clients been telling you of late, you know, in terms of how are they been adopting Industry 4.0, any new use cases that you can share? And my second part of the question is, it relates to the IoT platform, the PTC ThingWorx platform that you have, because given that there are more than 400 plus platforms today which are prevalent in the market, there's always that question, which is the right platform to choose? So if you can just very broadly share, what are the key considerations when one chooses a platform? That would be great, Raj. So starting with the trends, Raj.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you, Sunil. And I think everybody's pretty much summed it up pretty well. But I'll tell you our perspective, given the 35 years of manufacturing industry background that PTC as a company has, and about 11 years in the industrial IoT space, and similar in the augmented reality space, right? What manufacturers are telling us today, technology was always an enabler, right? But now, like you said, it is essential for survival. It's a savior now, right? I mean, when there is so many restrictions with the current situation in place, it is extremely difficult for people to be present. And therefore, how do you replace people? It's with technology, right? So industrial IoT, you know, like I think Saurabh said, condition monitoring and remote monitoring of assets on the shop floor, how do you operate them remotely, are all basic. And they always used to be the entry point. And that is even more pronounced now in the current situation. You, as a plant head, you'll want to control your factory operations, your assembly, your machines, your lines from your mobile phone. And that's all made very much possible with remote technologies. And also on the augmented reality front, right? The skills gap that I think was touched upon by Shankar as well as Saurabh to an extent, and that's a major problem across the world. The industry is transforming so quickly that you have to unlearn and relearn every single month, pretty much, probably every single day. And therefore, how do you enable people to learn in the most efficient manner? Okay, and that's what augmented reality brings to you. The fact that if you superimpose graphics and videos in the real physical space, augmenting a machine that you're seeing, you can train someone extremely faster. We're seeing 50, 60% improvements in how people are learning, how frontline workers are learning, as well as in servicing a machine. When you go and break fix, when you fix a machine that has a problem, how exactly do you fix a complex equipment? And augmented reality gives you the power to do that pretty much. And then IoT analytics, pretty much, where the operators, their efficiency goes up many fold when they have insights at their disposal, right? So what manufacturers are telling us today is that they're actually accelerating their digital transformation plans. If they had a plan to do this in the next 12 to 18 months in the past, right? They're now saying, it's essential for us to do it. It's essential for us to do it now. Therefore, we've got to think about it and make it a top priority, even though the market is shocked because of the current situation and effects on supply and demand, right, from the market. So manufacturers are doing that, and the more visionary manufacturers are obviously doing it at a much faster rate. So heavy equipment, heavy engineering are the top adopters. Automotive is an adopter. Of course, pharma, life sciences, CPG are essential goods in the current scenario. And therefore, they all want to make sure that they are supplying to meet the demand. Now, what are the considerations for an industrial IoT platform? Now, you talked about thinking big, thinking at scale, et cetera, right? So the consideration, particularly in the current scenario, is think time to market and think scale. So because an industrial IoT platform that you are putting in place now is going to be the reality forever, pretty much, because the fourth industrial revolution is here to stay. We are using the previous industrial revolutions were about the computers and internet, and it's only getting enhanced even more and more. So it's essential for manufacturers to make sure they make a conscious decision to put a solid, robust industrial IoT platform in place today. Now, what is a solid industrial IoT platform? One that, of course, has the ability to talk to a majority of machines and equipments on the shop floor for data extraction capabilities. One that has got analytics and machine learning capabilities in the near future, when you have to incorporate predictive analytics and even, you know, reach the stage of prescriptive analytics, where you're actually given recommendations from the IoT platform as to what exactly to do. And then probably to also have augmented reality capabilities as an integral part of your IoT platform. So an ideal IoT platform should have all of these capabilities that are there. So when there are 400 platforms in the market, like you said, Sunil, it is probably essential to zero that down to a very small number of platforms which have got all of these capabilities, and start small with the basic use cases like condition monitoring, OEE improvements, remote operational intelligence, but also have that vision in mind where you will reach a ideal state of supply chain visibility, performance benchmarking, descriptive analytics, and prescriptive analytics pretty much. So that's the ideal state. So when a company is charting out their IoT plans, they should actually have that whole vision in place, no matter where they are starting and what the initial use cases are.
Right. And Raj, I guess it has to be very modular, right? I mean, with a kind of a microservice kind of an architecture where you add applications as and when you want to, right? Give the manufacturers those flexibility, right? Right, Raj?
Absolutely. And with a robust platform in place that makes you easy to get to market or start implementing these use cases together, platforms such as these have got a microservices architecture pretty much, right? So it is modular. So you can start off with a few use cases. And a lot of client companies are starting off with, you know, a very basic energy optimization use case, for example, right? I mean, energy is wasted pretty much in almost every company, to different degrees, of course. And how do you start with that? So you can start off with that. So that could be the first module. Condition monitoring can be the second module, and then expand and go along the spectrum to the more high value use cases. And there's tremendous value that is there. If you do a structured approach of actually seeing the finances and working with the numbers and see where you can save even a small 2-5% improvements, which a lot of companies are getting in terms of their productivity improvements, that translates into crores of rupees, really, for a medium-sized company. So there's value with all of them.
Right. Thanks, Raj. Shankar, over to you. So Shankar, when you made your initial remarks, you talked about the skilling part, right? So today, when you look at manufacturing, the industry, and people who come out of college, manufacturing today is not considered cool, right? People would ideally want to get into an IT or an ITS company or a Google or a Facebook, you know, all these tech platforms. So from a manufacturing industry perspective, what do you think can be done to attract people to the industry? Now, given that every industry is now techified just using that word techified, because you need technology in every sphere of life today, including industry. So how do you attract people, Shankar, from a skill standpoint? How do you make sure that you're able to get the right level of skill? And second part of my question, if you can also talk about the startup ecosystem, and do you engage with the startups? Because there is a tremendous opportunity today, and maybe the startup today may not have access to these opportunities, right? So is Mahindra kind of playing that role of acting as a bridge between the startup and those opportunities which are there?
Sure. I'm sure you're aware that Mahindra is equally big in the farms equipment space also. It's not just the automotive. Right. So when we talk about IoT, we are looking at not just connected cars and the smart factories. We are also looking at precision farming, those kind of connected farms, where we can actually help the farmers to use the available resources in a very optimal manner and also help them to improve their productivity very significantly. So in both these spaces, both the automotive and the farm, we do constantly scout for some of these good tech startups in the space, both within India and abroad. And we continuously do interact with them at different levels. And we also have our R&D and product development groups outside India. For example, Mahindra North America Tech Center is right there at Detroit. And we also have SsangYong in South Korea. Same way with, if you look at farm, we have Mitsubishi, the joint venture in Japan, and then parts of Europe, like Turkey, for example. A lot of the farm smart implements, which is basically the traditional agricultural implements with sensors and IoT on it. Those kind of things have happened through acquisitions and also joint ventures, a variety of ecosystem. So we can't do this alone. Surely the smart way to do that is to find who are those real good guys who already made some advances in this, partner with them and bring in the scale. And also we are able to also, based on our rich experience making products, manufacturing them in India, we are able to give these products to the Indian customers at a very, very affordable cost. For example, when we looked at the autonomous tractor, so we are not actually looking at autonomous car, we are looking at autonomous tractor. And this is a very small, compact tractor with semi-autonomous features, which an Indian farmer can actually afford to buy. So that's a kind of technology pricing that we are looking at. Use the right technologies and put them together at the right price so that the end user, farmer in India, can actually afford to buy this product and use. Those are the kind of innovation directions that we are actually focusing on. And that's why we have this, build this ecosystem of a variety of technology innovation partners across industry, startups, and even academia to put together this. And this has taken a few years for us to build this system. Looking at in terms of attracting students to this space, I know it's equally challenging. See, both manufacturing and also agriculture, these two areas are not that attractive for a lot of the younger crowds, millennials and the Gen Z. So we thought, how can we make it attractive for them? How we can bring technology into these two areas in a real big way and make it quite attractive for them to get into the space? And how do we tell them all about this? So I used to go for recruitments and across all IITs, across the country, I used to travel to look for these bright kids and bring them into Mahindra. I thought I should do it a little early on. So we started working with students right from their first year onwards across through technology hackathons. We used to bring a lot of interesting industry challenges for these hackathons, some of them manufacturing related, some of them precision farm related, variety of these lesser known areas into the hackathons as industry challenges to work on. And then it's not just selecting the best and giving away a prize, but over the next 3 years of the undergrad, bring them to the Mahindra Research Valley, which is in Chennai, and through summer internships, so that they are able to work on the problem over the 4 year of their undergrad curriculum, and they are able to bring it to a good shape. And we had students working on robotic fruit pluckers and whatnot, variety of things that happen out of this. And more importantly, not just training the students and exposing them, it's also exposing the faculty members to that. So every time we brought a bunch of students for internships through these hackathons, we also made sure that faculty members also were at the Mahindra Research Valley for those summer 2 months. And they deeply embed themselves in one of the ongoing projects so that we give them maximum exposure, so that when they go back to their universities, they'll be able to share those real experiences and industry practices with a larger group of students. So we started giving them mini sabbaticals to expose them. It's not only at the Research Valley, but also in our manufacturing plants where we have this Industry 4.0 initiatives. So we started bringing students and faculties through this mini sabbaticals. And that's how slowly the word spread that this is an interesting space and there are so many interesting problems to work on. And over the last couple of years, I'm seeing a lot of traction in this space. We are able to attract very good talent. And once they come, We spent the next 6 months training them further at the Mahindra Technical Academy, which is a fairly big investment Mahindra has made, only for technical capability building. This is right at the center of a product development Mahindra Research Valley. So we trained these fresh hires from the campuses for an extended period of about 6 months in all these new tech areas, which would include IoT, robotics, AI, machine learning, a whole bunch of things over and above their core engineering knowledge. And then we assign them to the various ongoing projects. So this is the way we have been able to attract talent into this space. And we need engineers of all kinds to work on these programs, mechanical, electrical, electronics, computer science. So bringing them all together in a cross-functional team, making them speak each other's language, understand each other's language, also bringing in design thinking and innovation for these young engineers. This has been a very, very exciting time that we had over the last 3 years doing all these things.
Thank you. Thank you, Shankar. Great initiative, Shankar. Saurabh, over to you. So Saurabh, now in your Industry 4.0 journey, before you selected the right partner, I would want to use the word partner here and not a vendor, but you would have obviously had to look at multiple options, right? So what are the key criteria which you use in selecting the right partner who can help you through this whole journey, Saurabh, if you can very briefly share?
I think it's very simple. First is understanding of the use case. The partner should have a good understanding of the use case which you are trying to solve. They should be part of the solution with you so that they can contribute directly and be part of the entire journey. They should have good integration skills, because as I said in my earlier conversation, that IoT is not just limited to IoT. It can be multiple other enabling technologies surrounding it, right? So the integration capability should be very good enough, and they should be able to work across multiple players. And last but not the least, since these are production units, and in some cases, if there is a local support needed, they should have capability to provide that local support.
Right, and Saurabh, what would be your approach? I mean, would you want to work with one partner who would work with the whole ecosystem? Are you okay to work with multiple partners or someone to play that role of enabling that whole ecosystem? So what would be your approach, Saurabh?
So it can be, so we are still in the experimental stage. We are again, as Dr. Venugopal mentioned, we are also experimenting with our university. We are working with the OPJU Punjipatra to see if we can create a center of excellence there around IoT and analytics, and see how can they contribute and create a larger ecosystem. Because if you look at these technologies, typically all the new generation curriculums are very much aligned to these technologies, right? So one is building an in-house capability to an extent where the model becomes replicable, right? Mr. Lokesh was mentioning, I think he mentioned, the ability to be scale up, right? That's very important. Doing a POC is very simple, but taking it beyond the POC, so scalability is very, very important. So I think it will be a mix of both. It will be both in-house as well as the right partner ecosystem to give the framework and the right skill set, but it's just the jump start.
Right. Thanks, Saurabh. Lokesh, over to you. And this is one offline question that came to us earlier, and this relates to the MSME industry. And if I recollect, Lokesh, I think last year, Bosch came up with a platform called Phantom, if I'm not mistaken, which is targeting the MSME industry, right? So in terms of getting the MSMEs to adopt IoT, what would your advice be to them, Lokesh? Is Bosch engaging with the MSMEs? Because they are obviously very critical to the overall manufacturing ecosystem.
Yeah, we are indeed. We are closely working with multiple MSCs, because that's a supply chain network we have to work with, right? Because industrial IoT is customer of a customer and supplier of supplier. So you need to integrate everything, everyone, in one single value chain, if I can call, to get a better benefit. Otherwise, it's not going to be useful going further. So we are engaging. The Phantom is doing pretty well. So we have the next generation Phantom release, and we're working towards it. The suggestion, or perhaps as a partner, if I have to give a partner suggestion to MSMEs, is start with an intent. Start with an intent that you want to move from MSME to a larger enterprise, you know, that all of us would like to dream. Any NSME do not want to stand there, they want to scale up. All these companies which have, including Bosch, have started as MSMEs, started as a startup, and we are an enterprise, and a lot of companies, whether it's one infra, whether it's any company for that matter. So MSMEs, they should have an intent. That intent has to have a backed up with the right blueprinting, and then you so on and so forth. Because ultimately, when you take care of your customer, what does customer want? Customer wants quality. That's the most important aspect of it. He doesn't want you to price. He can certainly negotiate. He does have a price point, but he's ready to pay if you provide a good quality product. Yeah, hence, I at times I fail to understand why India has always run behind this cost element. We are a 400 billion manufacturing output country, whereas China is 4 trillion. And when you have this comparison, where Germany is 800 billion plus, so we do have a lot to catch up. So hence, let's catch up with an intent to catch up, with backed up with the technology usage, jump onto it. Please do jump onto it, because government is supporting. When I travel to Turkey, when I see that the intent is extremely high compared to India, nothing wrong in, we do have to learn from it, but it's an observation I've had. So hence, start with an intent to scale up. Start with an intent that I don't want to be called as MSMEs in coming years. I want to be called as an enterprise. And that intent backed up with right, choosing the right partner, like Saurabh mentioned, where whoever it could be Bosch, PTC, Siemens, whoever it could be, whether a consulting firm, do selecting, stay with that partner and grow together. So that would help in going in a larger extent. I do see a lot of MSMEs coming forward. I do see them taking chances. I do see them making a bold decisions to invest, and that's giving them results.
Great. Fantastic. Thanks, Lokesh. And before we move to the questions from the audience, my question to Raj. So Raj, you talked about AR and VR use cases. You talked about remote support, training. Now, AR, VR is not cheap, right? I mean, the hardware is still considered expensive. So is this the inflection point, but perhaps see a lot more adoption of AR and VR? And are we going to see costs of headsets perhaps coming down going forward, Raj? And will there be flexibility in terms of people who are offering this to offer it as a service, so there's no one-time capex? Are we going to see some innovation in the way these are offered to customers?
Okay, so first of all, I think, yes, the AR, VR devices and the wearables costs are actually coming down. Two, even in the market today, there's very affordable wearable devices that you can actually wear and get into industrial use cases as well. But wearable is not an essential, really. You know, if you wearable is an essential only if you want your hands free. But if you're fixing a machine and you can do that with one hand, or fix the phone somewhere, you can even have a handheld device to look at the augmented reality experience. You can do that with a mobile phone. It's very easy. You can download an application and generate an experience. You can do that with a tablet. And so you don't really need a wearable device to experience the AR experience, right? So, but on the other side, if it's an industrial grade use case where you've got to have both your hands free, you're getting work instructions, you're getting assembly instructions, then you probably need to have your hands free. And yes, the wearable, as the economies of scale take effect, the wearable prices are coming down, and there's more and more wearables in the industry, right? So So AR, VR is really catching on pretty much, and people are really seeing the value of implementing AR technology, which earlier was perceived as a buzz, and that was a major problem in convincing the market. But also when they see the value that comes out of it and it's quantified in actual money, people do see the training, servicing, you know, instructions, assembly instructions, as well as operation instructions are all made much easier with AR technology.
Right, thanks, Raj. And I think we'll probably take some questions now from the Q&A chat box. So I think there was one question related to, I think this is addressed to you, Shankar. What is the budget allocation for digitization in terms of percentage of turnover within Mahindra? Would you want to take that?
So we are investing almost more than 10% on specifically the new technologies, which broadly we refer to as advanced technologies. And I think the digital would constitute almost 70 to 80% when I talk about advanced technologies, the entire portfolio, almost 80% of it would be digital. This includes running a lot of exploratory innovation projects and also trainings at all levels, right from the foundational level to a very advanced practitioner level training. And this would also include some of the collaborative projects that we run with the external ecosystem. So it's a combination of all these things. So this would be constitute more than 10% actually that we are investing on this space. And this is very much needed at this time because the initial momentum, and we also need to do it very quickly. And in fact, this COVID has accelerated this whole work. And over the last 2 years, if you see, we have this Mahindra Innovation Awards. And in that, we also have a category called Dare to Dream, where these are the very tough projects people have taken, knowing fully well that there's a finite probability that it may not work. So they get to present these things to the top leadership. So in this, we are seeing more and more of IoT and digital related projects that are being presented in this space, where people are able to come out of their comfort zone, play around with a lot of these new technologies, and really create a lot of valuable learnings for the product development organization out of these experiments right. that they are running. So this is where we are right now.
Thank you, Shankar. Saurabh, there's one question for you around IIoT security. Now, with all these assets connected to the internet, obviously the threat vector gets widened. So how does the manufacturing industry, how do manufacturers secure their assets? So maybe you can share some light on this, on the security piece, Saurabh, please.
So security is a very interesting subject. And I always say that the weakest link is never the technology. The weakest link is having a weak password like admin, right? That's where you, every time, you never get breached through your firewalls. So said that, the most important thing nowadays is the mediation, because this is where you are actually collating the entire L1 data and then pumping it either into L2 or something. So you need to keep this entire layer as read-only, where the upper level MES interacts only with the smart manufacturing as a read-only and do not put the data back, right? So as long as you do this, you are controlling it. But then, as I said, it's IoMT is not just about the sensors putting out data. It's about the ecosystem, right? So how do you actually control security? You just apply five things, right? Identify what process and asset needs protection. Protect, what safeguards to protect them. Detect, what are the technologies available. Respond, if it happens, what is the impact which will happen? And last is, what are your restoration capabilities, right? As long as you have done across this checklist, across the entire landscape, you will be able to clearly define what is the security threat you are carrying.
Right. I think, Saurabh, also what is needed is a layered approach to security, right? I guess you've got to have security at multiple layers to be able to secure the whole system, so to speak, right?
Absolutely.
Right. Thanks, Saurabh. Lokesh, this question is for you. This is from Anil Deshmukh. He asks you how Bosch can join hands with consultants who wish to work in this area, which is Industry 4.0, and support to shop floor to top floor implementing this in MSME. So that's the question for you, Lokesh. How can Bosch can work with consultants in this space?
Sure. Again, it comes to fact that we need to go a little deeper. What consultancy are you Are you offering a manufacturing consultancy, a technology consultancy, or a business consultancy? Based on that, we can join hands. We have, as I mentioned, partners. There are multiple of them. We do have a few partners who are consulting firms. We do have partners technology. We have partners with product companies who have built in product, and we are integrating that into our ecosystem. So happy to join hands. Please do join me whenever LinkedIn or my phone number, everything is available. Happy to take that further.
Right. So I think, Nitya, what we should do is perhaps get some clarity around this question. I think it was a little vague, but maybe we can have him reach out to us separately, and maybe we can get Lokesh connected to him. Raj, the questions around return on investment, ROI, and Industry 4.0. People probably want immediate returns. Obviously, that's not going to be possible. So how does one go about looking at ROI, and can throw some light on that? Raj, please.
Oh, that's a question I get very often. And I think companies will only spend a percentage amount of the overall value that they derive, given a whatever amount of time frame, right? 3 years, 5 years. So the approach for us as PTC has always been to look at whether there's really value that companies derive from the digital transformation initiative that they're taking up. So ROI is extremely relevant. I think it is something that will justify the business or the spend within every organization. Now, I'll talk about a few percentages. Now, at a very basic level, when companies are, when manufacturers are implementing IoT technologies, there is a 5 to 8% productivity increase. There is a 5 to 6% unscheduled downtime benefit, right? And these are the very basic things to start off with. And then if you go to the very top of the pyramid of use cases, which when the complexities increase, you see that the learning ability and the benefits of authoring time as well as training time, et cetera, decrease 50 to 60%, if augmented reality technologies are incorporated. And all of this translates to multifold benefits. Now, if you actually put it in rupee terms or in, let's say, multiples of investment terms, I would say in the first year, you're probably, if you spent X on the digital initiative, and that X involves not just the software cost, but the sensor cost, the services, the internal transformation and initiative costs as well, you probably will get to a break-even point, say one and a half years down the line. But then you'll see a rapid increase after that. You see a 5X kind of a return probably in two and a half years. And if you consider a time frame of 4 years when you incorporated a variety of use cases, the best benefits we are seeing is in the range of 15 to 20X. Okay, so you get back that much. And that's the kind of power that digital transformation has. And I talk with facts on McKinsey reports and BCG reports across the world with manufacturers that have adopted technology very early, probably 5-6 years ago. So if you want specifics on all that, on all the studies that have been done, I think you can reach out to me to give you that. And these are third-party studies, not things that PTC have done. So there's massive benefit behind it.
Good. Thanks, Raj. Nitya, we have lots of questions, but do you have time? I can probably take two more. Can we extend this for another 5 to 7 minutes? Nitya, is that okay with you and all the panelists?
Yeah, we can answer two more questions, yes. And the rest of the questions can be taken over to our interchange community. Yeah.
Right. So, Shankar, there's this question directed to you. Since you talked about how do you skill people, there's this question from Prakash asking you, is it not a good idea to make engineers at college education level itself rather than spending another 3 years to develop the engineers at the plant? So I think the question is more around how do you make them industry ready, skill them in this college itself so that they are ready to take up any kind of industry assignment.
Absolutely. So, I think we need that much more time to make this happen. So it is best done when we start with the college itself. So I have been working with a lot of the new IITs to design curriculums around these new technology areas and also bring the industry angle to that. So I have been in their curriculum committees to design these courses. But interestingly, I would go one step even beyond that. It's not sufficient if we start in the college. We should catch them when they are in school itself. So I'm running a innovation initiative called KinderSpark, that we reach out to children anywhere from 7th, 8th grade all the way to 12th grade. And we introduce IoT-based projects to them. And it's all done online. During those last 3-4 months, this has all been virtual sessions on Sundays. And the kind of ideas and the confidence with which they are able to do their POCs, these kids who are still at school, is amazing. And that's what gives me the confidence that we are going to really pick this up very fast and going to really make a big impact.
Right. I think there are about 3,000 Atal Tinkering Labs across the country, if I'm not mistaken. Right, Shankar?
Yeah, absolutely. And the schools are actually struggling because they have good facility and the teachers are busy teaching the regular curriculum. They need people from the industry to help them to actually expose all these kids. The kids are very excited, so the schools need help. That's where I thought we could pitch in and start helping them out. And that is becoming very, very interesting now.
Okay, so I'm going to ask the last question. And this question is to all the panelists. And this question is about this whole concept of a dark factory. Dark factory, as you know, is a completely automated factory with robots and AGVs and all that. So the question is, and I'm actually adding to this question, say in 5 to 7 years from now, do you think India would have dark factories? Yes or no, from all the panelists? Starting with you, Shankar.
Yes. Not really. I would like to have a factory where the humans and the robots work together, what we call as cobots, because that is definitely important. That's the way I see the future.
Okay. Lokesh, what did the crystal ball reveal to you? 5 years from now, fully automated?
No, I did write a blog on that lights on, right? So dark or lights on factory, you call it. India, it's, I go with the mixed bag approach here. I wouldn't like to have a complete lights on factory because India is our strength is our human resources. So whenever, whatever solution you want to develop, you have to keep people in center. Of course, you have to scale your business so that you do offer employment to everyone who is coming out. Otherwise, this will be a chaoticness, chaos in the India economic system. Yeah, it's not going to be easy. Take my word. We are not going to go back to 500 million of people. We are 1.3. The statistics say that by 2100 we will go back to 1.1 billion. So we still 100 years from now also we're still going to be a billion people. So we do need people to work. We do need factories to grow. So I would have a mixed bag approach there. Both,
right.
We need to coexist.
All right.
Saurabh? It will be hybrid, no dark. There will be some elimination.
Okay. That's nice. Okay. Raj, the final word to you before we wrap up.
Technology is never going to replace human beings. It's only going to make human beings more insightful, stronger, smarter, etc. Right? So, we don't have to be really worried about it. But as a technologist, it's a marvel to have a dark factory, which is in concept right now, to actually see that in implementation. So the technologist in me wants it to happen, but I know with facts, it's not going to happen for a very long time.
Thank you, Raj. And I think with that, we are done with all the questions. So those who couldn't get the question answered, we can maybe have them addressed offline. So Nitya, maybe you can collect these questions separately and have the panelists address some of those questions. But I would like to thank all the panelists for sharing their insights. I think it's been a fantastic discussion. So while the opportunity is huge, notwithstanding the challenges, we all know the challenges, but I think there is tremendous opportunity today within the manufacturing industry to accelerate the digital transformation initiatives. So it's not just to survive, but also to thrive in the new normal. And there's enough opportunity, I think, for startups to engage, for solution providers to offer really low-cost solutions. I think there's enough tremendous opportunity. I think it's important for the all ecosystem to come together, including the academia. So thank you so much once again, the virtual audience for joining us. And Nitya, over to you. You have a final poll before we wrap up.
Correct. Thank you, Mr. David. Any unanswered questions can be taken over to our Interchange community platform. The link will be shared at the end of this session. Thank you, panelists, for taking out time to share your thoughts. It has indeed been an insightful session. I request the audience to take a moment to complete the poll and provide feedback on today's session and share your ideas for future discussions. The poll is on your screen right now. Your feedback is extremely important for us to bring more and more such sessions to you. Details on joining the Interchange community platform where you can post your unanswered questions will soon be on your screen and will also be a part of the email that you will receive after this session. I encourage you to join and engage with the community for deeper discussions. Look out for details on upcoming sessions on our IIoT India website and social media pages. Once again, thank you for joining us and we hope you found it useful. We look forward to seeing you in the Interchange after this session and having you at our future sessions. Do not forget to submit your poll once you are through with it. Take care and have a good day ahead.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye.